ओवर टू डॉक्टर शिव प्रसाद सर।
Hello, good evening. We are in the middle of our webinar series, Provision, Mission Possible. And I'm very happy to welcome you all to this today's webinar series. I welcome our administrator, Reverend Father Roshan Krasta, to this webinar series program today. I'm very happy to welcome my teacher, our teacher, and teacher of teachers, Dr. S.K. Tiwari, to this webinar series, because he's the today's resource person to speak on homeopathy prescribing. So I welcome you, sir, to this program. I also welcome Dr. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir, we can hear you.
I also welcome all the participants who are a part of this webinar series since the last 14 days. I can welcome you all again to this program. I also welcome the moderator for today's session, Dr. M.K. Kamath, Professor and Head of the Department of Medicine and Homeopathic Therapeutics. Now I would like to invite Dr. M.K. Kamath, moderator, to carry on with the proceedings. Dr. Kamath, over to you.
Yeah. Hi, hello everyone. Welcome once again for the second session of the day. I'm happy and honored to introduce the second speaker of the day, Dr. S.K. Tiwari. I don't know who said this, but it is fits Dr. Tiwari, and all who know sir will agree with me. I quote, "A teacher plants seeds of knowledge, sprinkles them with love, and patiently nurtures their growth to produce tomorrow's dreams." He is committed homeopath through and through. For 25 long years, he was our teacher and principal at Father Muller's Homeopathic Medical College. Then he went on to become director of NIH Calcutta. Presently, he is also guide and examiner for PhD scholars at Homeopathic University, Jaipur, India. He has authored Essentials of Repertorization and Homeopathy and Child Care. In association with Central Council of Research Homeopathy, Government of India, sir has authored several books like Menopause, Diabetes, Mellitus, Prescribing, etc. He has served CCRH as expert in various committees. He has also received, revised and edited Father Muller's repertory. Recently, he has published a book, which is a translation in Kannada language, which is titled as Makkala Kailegalige Homeopathy Aushadha. He has published several articles in different journals and presented more than 100 papers in national and international conferences. Some important and memorable conferences abroad are conferences at Canada, Moscow, Leipzig, Cape Town, organized by LMHI. Presently, he is serving homeopathy through his frequent lectures at various homeopathic medical colleges, giving seminars and holding workshops on education and practice of homeopathy in India and abroad. He has established his own clinic at Mangalore, Karnataka. He has been practicing homeopathy for more than 36 long years. His specialized field of interest is allergy and asthma, infertility, vitiligo, children and female diseases, lifestyle disorders and surgical diseases. I had many occasions to work with him at close quarters and had the opportunity to observe what is Dr. Tiwari. I can say he is a simple man who loves his work. A note to all participants, the speaker will take questions at the end of the session. Today, sir will walk us along the most interesting path of prescribing in homeopathy. Sir, we would love to hear from you. Over to you, sir.
Should I start now?
Yes, sir.
Welcome all of you to this ongoing webinar organized by Father Muller's Homeopathic Medical College. And I must thank Dr. Shiv Prasad, the principal, father, administrator, director, and the person who introduced me, Dr. Kamath. Dr. Kamath and Dr. Shiv Prasad has told very good words about me that must have raised a big expectation in your mind. But to tell you frank, I am just a homeopathic practitioner, and I have gone through the lecturership, the professorship, the guide for PhD. Finally, I realized that practice is something which is very close to the theory. Sometimes we say theory is different, practice is different, but it is not true. To be more practical is to be more theoretical, at least in homeopathy. This topic of prescribing in homeopathy has been taken because now prescribing in homeopathy has come to a crossroad. There are several ways to practice. There are several deviations from the original practice, which is not at all welcomed. We have to stick to principle, and then only homeopathy works. That is what I have seen in my practice. There are various types of cases. You can differ in prescribing in methodology, but you cannot deviate actually from the original principle of homeopathy. So let us come to the topic prescribing, which is very, very important, very, very relevant in today's practice. And I can see so many people joining this. I'm very happy because in Corona time, when all are joining are healthy, our friends are healthy, colleagues are healthy, it's a matter of pride that most of the homeopaths are healthy in spite of they are exposed, maybe because of the immune booster they are taking. So I welcome all of you with these few words. I'll go directly to the topic. Prescribing. What is prescribing? See, prescribing comes to the end of our case taking, end of understanding patient, and it is the action which a physician takes after understanding the patient, after understanding the sickness. So this is a decision actually. It's an action. It is a function of physician, ultimate function, to give appropriate instruction about treatment to a person with intention to make him healthy. And it is just not a paper and pen and writing of the name of medicine. Because many people feel that prescription means there should be a letterhead, there should be a pen, and you write something. That is not prescription. And you write something which nobody can read. That is not a prescription. Whenever you know there is a bad handwriting, people say it's a doctor's handwriting. And that is already seen in the prescription. So my dear friends, prescription does not mean just writing the name of medicine. It includes correction in mode of living, but because that may be the cause. Right food habits as per the disease. Because a patient you are treating and patient is diabetes and he is eating sugar, you are giving all good medicines, nothing will happen. Patient is having cold, cough, and he's taking something which is making it worse. So right food habit also along with the medicine. And removing maintaining cause. Maintaining cause, which is maintaining the disease, sometimes we are able to find out, sometimes we are not. Sometimes in our world, it's a miasm, sometimes something in the constitution. That we have to understand after taking the case. And there are some do's and don'ts about the disease, about your medicine also. See, do's and don'ts, people say in homeopathy, there are a lot of do's and don'ts. So patient try to avoid homeopathy prescriptions. See, one patient told me, doctor, I want homeopathic medicine. But the problem is, he will say, don't take tea, don't take garlic, don't take onion, don't take ginger. So this is all wrong concepts. Restriction we have, it may be as per the disease, and as per the medicines. For example, Tusa. when we prescribe to the, we may ask the person not to take tea because it doesn't agree, it aggravates. So as per medicines, as per disease, there are do's and don'ts, but don't generalize and try to clear this wrong concept from the public. Then last comes indicated medicine with suitable dose. Here I tell you, just selection of medicine is not enough unless it is prescribed with whatever is required dose. Sometimes you may select after all discussion, repertorization, name of one medicine has come, but how to prescribe, that is very important. So in every case, it may differ. So this is prescribing. Prescribing means to treat a patient with all instruction and medicines with suitable doses. Our master Hanuman has clearly explained everything aphorism 3. I am not going to discuss theoretically, but few important things, especially four important things. His first line in aphorism is, if a physician clearly perceives what is to be cured in a disease, in bracket he say indications. So disease and indication is important. Indication means something other than disease also. So he should know, for a prescribing, he should know what is health, what is sickness, what has made the person to deviate from health to the sickness, and then what is the indicated medicine and what instruction he should give to the patient. So these are important things which Hanuman has already described for prescription. See, prescription, as I say, the selection of medicine is the last, and which is also very important. Now let us see, selection of medicine in homeopathy means what? Selection of medicine is based on law of similar. You know, law of similar is a nature's law. It's a non-failing, never failing law, even in medicine. What we have to do in law of similar? To know law of similar, what, how should we apply? We have picture of diseased person. That comes after case study. And then picture of medicines, what we study in medicine. This has to be tagged. This has to be compared. And they should be similar as much as possible. More the similar, better is the prescription. Aim of physician should be to look for a medicine which is as closely similar to the picture of sick as possible, to match the portrait of disease to the medicine. This is whole thing what a physician has to do for a prescription. If he is able to do, surely, certainly, he will achieve his aim, that is cure. Now what Kent says about that? The success of prescribing depends upon totality of the symptoms. And any given totality affords indifferent mark, either indifferent result or marked success. This depends on how totality has been conceived. To be able to view the totality of symptoms, most similar remedy will appeal. Mind is the aim of all healing artists. As it varies, so varies the success. So everything depends on totality, as Kent says, by first fixing. Now, what Kent is suggesting, how to arrive at totality? By first fixing in mind, what symptoms are common? As we teachers always say in our classroom also, in our demonstration of the case taking and practical also, divide the whole case taking into common and uncommon. So that is what Kent is suggesting. First fixing in the mind, what are the commons? Like in a disease, we know from the knowledge of practice of medicine, what are the common symptoms? So once we know what are the common symptoms, all remaining things are uncommon symptoms. In other words, strange, rare, and peculiar. Then he is taking, common symptoms are such as pathognomy, disease symptoms, pathology, and many remedies have all this. like constipation, nausea, irritability. These are common symptoms, weeping. So there are mental common symptoms and there are physical common symptoms. In repertory, if you look, sadness is the most common, biggest rubric in repertory. Because sadness is very common in people. Especially in corona time, you see, sadness has become a very, very common symptom. So you cannot prescribe for sadness. You have to prescribe for sadness when, what makes it bad, what makes it better, what causes sadness. That is what Kane says, qualified mental symptoms. So all common symptoms, he says, they are not important because they are found in most of the remedies and most of the people also. When such symptoms have taken their places in a given case, it will see at once that what remedy must be uncommon. Therefore, peculiar and characteristic symptoms are predicted of the patient as the whole of his part in particular. However, some of these common symptoms may be important when they are marked with some modalities. It must now be seen that, I think some of the slide is covered with the photos. Can you listen to me? Anyway, it must now be seen that physician should not concern more of the pathology. And if he prescribes for the result of endings, for the things first, not for the cause, these ultimate symptoms are of least value study. So as I was telling, we have to divide everything into common and uncommon. Common symptoms are mostly the pathological symptoms, end results of the disease, pathological symptoms, and hence they are not very important for prescription. And what is remaining uncommon symptoms, they belong to the patient, and that is why they are very important symptoms. Let's see what Boger says. Boger says is correct prescribing in the art of carefully fitting pathogenetic clinical symptoms. And as such, it requires three things. Spatial aptness in grasping the essential points of symptom series. See, when you have taken the case, we have to find out what are the essential points of symptoms. And then working knowledge of material or skillful use of repertories and books of records. So essential points you must get from the case. And then if you have working knowledge of material medica, you can prescribe. Or you must refer to repertories. How to obtain a picture? Asking patient to tell his or her own story. Even Hahnemann has said, let the patient tell all the story and don't disturb when patient is talking. But now you see this much closeness in our corona call. Is not allowed and not good also. So we have to find out by symptoms. Now, even there are people now, they have learned how to prescribe even by the phone calls. Because symptoms are important, and once you understand what are the important symptoms and what are not important symptoms, you can prescribe. So case taking, allow patient to tell everything, even on the phone, even when you are talking to a person, or even patient is sitting in front of you. And then find out the cause and course of sickness, starting point and the last point. And then find out the modalities. See, modalities are given very, very important in homeopathy. And some of the factors in modalities you must keep in mind is time, in which part of the day or night the symptoms are more, temperature, heat, cold, open air, motion, actually eating and drinking, touch, pressure, discharge, etc. So these are some of the modifying factors which we must look at. Then mental state comes. And third step, this step is suggested by Bogle. Patient own description of his sensation. These are all subjective symptoms. So let patient describe. And these are the examples you can observe. You can take note from the patient when the patient is describing, and you can understand what is severe symptoms, what is the intensity of symptom by patient's description. Fourth step is dealing with objective aspect. Now, because our faces are mostly covered by mask, these facial expressions will be a little difficult to observe. But then any other objective symptoms like discoloration, pigmentation, all those things we can observe. Lastly, the part affected must be determined. And this is the local part, pathology, and even lab investigation. See, Bogle was very much aware of the pathology, and he has suggested lab investigation must be done in every case. Now, after considering these two stalwarts, we know what kind of symptoms of the patient should be compared with what kind of symptoms in the remedy. Different stalwarts have expressed different views on this very important topic. But majority agree that only characteristic symptoms are regarded, and those symptoms should be of equal importance both in patient and for the remedy. I'll tell you what it is like. Like there is a strong craving for sweet in a patient. You have to find a medicine which has a strong craving for sweet, not just one mark. So the intensity should be also seen, like burning better by hot. You have to find out a medicine which has burning, what degree of burning and what degree of ammunition by hot. It may be arsenic, it may be rattania, it may be ascula. These are all better by hot. But the degree of heat ameliorates the degree of burning is more in arsenic. So that kind of study has to be done. And it should be found in the patient also. Therefore, the most characteristic symptoms of the patients are taken, and that is known by case-taking, analysis, and synthesis. And then compared to the extract and characterizing symptoms of the medicine. So the aim should be to look for similar. Totality of patients should be exactly similar or similar, let us say, to the totality of medicine. So now we understood what is totality. Is it sum total of symptoms? Is it sum total of disease symptoms? Is it sum total of pathological symptoms? Is it sum total of patient symptoms? So from the earlier discussion, we understood that totality means sum total of patient symptoms, characteristic symptoms, which makes us understand the patient as well as disease, but patient is first. And these are all described by our master. What he says, in this search of homeopathic specific remedy, it is that the comparison of collective symptoms of the natural disease, the list of symptoms of known medicine to find among these an artificial morbid agent corresponding by similarity to the disease. So some people say specific remedy. What is specific remedy? Specific remedy is one which is very similar to the patient. And then he is telling those symptoms are more striking, similar, uncommon, and peculiar. And then he goes on saying that the symptoms which are general, like headache, loss of appetite, debility, restlessness, these are all vague and they are not characteristic symptoms. So from all our discussions, we have seen the views of Hannibal, the ultimate person, Kent, and Vogel. What kind of symptoms we have to look into the case? Just to summarize, we have to look for modalities. I will make it easy because modalities looking is very, very easy. Look for modalities. When patient describes headache, look for what factors ameliorates and aggravates his pain. What are the causation? What is the time? What is the temperature? What is the weather? Motion, eating, drinking, sleep, pressure, touch. So any symptoms, any disease, any problems told by the patient, we have to concentrate mainly on what modality is for that. Then look for all uncommon symptoms in the person. For that, you must know what are the common symptoms. Then symptoms belonging to the whole person, mental, physical, and then pathological symptoms, the tendencies, the common nature of pathology, and finally look for concomitants. So modalities, uncommon symptoms, patient symptoms, pathological generals, concomitant, and also keynotes. Keynotes, there is a very, very wrong concept. Keynotes does not mean prescribe on one symptom. See, Gurnessy has told, symptom which represents the whole remedy, that is keynote. So by getting such a symptom in a case, one can be quite sure that other symptoms of the case are also fitting. So if that kind of symptoms comes, you can go for the keynote. So you have to look for modalities, you have to look for uncommon symptoms, look for the patient symptoms, and look for concomitants and keynotes. Now, mostly, what type of cases we come across? We come across acute cases, chronic cases. These are all only two classification given in homeopathy. Based on this classification is based on causation theory. So acute cases, mostly we get acute cases. Chronic cases, no doubt homeopaths are very famous for chronic cases, but acute cases are also come every day in homeopathy. So we have acute cases, then chronic cases we have with characteristics. Chronic cases with dominant pathology and chronic cases with only clinical symptoms. So all these types of chronic cases, there should be different approach. Now we'll see what is acute case and how we are going to deal. I'll tell you with example a few cases. And what methodology we follow is non-repertorial. First is non-repertorial. Non-repertorial means when you are taking a case, in the process of taking a case, the medicine becomes clearer, clearer, and finally, when you finish the case taking, one or two remedies may be remaining in your mind, and you can easily differentiate. So this type of non-repertorial prescription, mostly they depend on your knowledge of medical medicine. Because non-repertorial approach, which you see the people who are having 20 years experience, 30 years experience, that can misguide you. Because when I was a student, I will tell you my story. I used to go to my own professor. He used to see patients, two, three questions, he used to prescribe. Then I was thinking, what is need of repertorization? Why should you go through such a laborious process? But to come to that stage, when you can prescribe on the basis of picking a few symptoms in the case, that takes time. And that is ladder steps. Even Kent says, if you repertorize 100 cases, you do not require further repertorization because you know already the process and the process goes in your mind. So non-repertorial, be careful. You should have the good knowledge of natural medica and good knowledge of comparative medicine, practical medicine. Then comes repertorial. I suggest beginners to follow repertorial method because it makes you sure about your medicine. In the preparatory method, we have Bonnington's method, Hoger method, Kent's method, and clinical method. So we'll see. These are the methodology, preparatory, non-preparatory. So we'll go to acute case first. What is acute disease? We all know. Acute diseases are defined as disease which begins suddenly, progress faster, run a definite course, and finally end either with death or recovery. They are caused by exciting cause. Contrary to general belief, I will tell you one thing. Most of the people think that, it's a common belief in society, that homeopathy is not good for acute disease. But as our masters have told, as we see in our clinic also, the result of acute disease are much, much better. In the case-taking portion, Hahnemann tells about acute case-taking. He's telling the acute case-taking is very easy because all symptoms are prominent. And patient do not forget to mention all important symptoms, important modalities, important concomitants. And what else you want in your prescription? You want only these things. You want modalities, you want intensity of symptoms, you want concomitant. And patient do not forget to mention the acute disease. So while attending to an acute case, physician should be able to limit his inquiry to the recent deviation from the health. Don't go for a lot of inquiries. If you're See, case taking should be over when you feel that you have got the characteristics and you are sure about the prescription. One case of intussusception I will share with you. You know what is intussusception? When the intestine, one part becomes weak and invaginates in another part, and there are a lot of complications. Is a process in which the segment of intestine resonates with another and causing obstruction. And from practice of medicine, from surgery, you know, the vomiting, constipation, pain will be very severe. This is a case. It's a diagnosed case of intussusception. He came with the report because he did not want operation and he wanted more. Okay, so the pain used to come and go suddenly. Patient was brought for home with the treatment because he was advised hospitalization for observation and if needed should go for surgery. And patient wanted to avoid that. History will share with you. Pain started suddenly at 3 a.m. He was given some buttermilk thinking he may be having some gas problem. Because it's a home treatment. He was taken for a medical checkup and the doctor suspected for worm infestation. Then he was given worm medicine. But the whole day pain continued. Every 1 hour it used to come and go. Pain continued throughout the night. Then he was taken to a medical college hospital. And he had earlier also abdominal pains. He was subjected to blood investigation and ultrasound. Ultrasonography revealed intussusception. And he preferred medicinal treatment because if a small child, parents will always have operations, and that is opening of abdomen. It's a big operation. This is the hospital record. You can see abdominal pain since 2 days, history of fever also, vomiting 3-4, non-projectile vomiting. And these are the treatment given. First, the doubt about appendicitis. Then ultrasound was done. In USG, abdominal, there is a transient intussusception referred to periodic surgery. Patient party was advised for admission, but patient is not willing and he will be coming tomorrow for admission. But he never went because he came with all these papers to me. These are the medicines. This is the ultrasound. And in ultrasound, you see a transient intussusception. you know, the doctor has told it is a transient, but it can become anytime severe, and patient can be a very serious problem. So this is a okay information. We wanted further information, further symptoms for our prescribing. So we have noted few things. The child was very irritable with the pain. Anger used to increase his pain. Pain was better by pressure. Child was lying on abdomen or curled up in order to relieve the pain. Hunger not reduced. He was asking for frequent food. So the group of remedy came to my mind was chamomilla because of the anger irritability. Staphylococcus because of that surgical. Colocin. But what was the most important symptom in this is the modality. Because of the prominent modalities, he was curled up, he was on the bed, pressing his stomach, and lying down. So he was prescribed colocin 200 every 2 hours for the pain. And I told him, give colocin every 2 hours till the pain subsides. Then slowly the severity of pain subsided in next 12 hours. Pain stopped. After the pain subsided, he was prescribed a deep breathing medicine. Then I have told him, when pain is stopped, you come here, bring him. And then I found few important things. This is after case taking I have put down. This is not case taking. What I observed is localized neuralgic pain was there. Constriction sensation in the whole internal organ along with the abdomen. Abdomen retracted. Constipation from the starting of the pain. It is not after the interception constipation started. But even with the, before that constipation was there. And this is a starting, during, and after. So this was taken as a concomitant. Though, if it comes during pain, during intussusception, it becomes only a common concomitant. But because constipation from the starting of pain he had, this became very important, and that abdomen retracted. You must be knowing what is the medicine. He was prescribed Plumber Med 30, and then pain stopped completely since last evening, past soft and solid motion and desire for food good, overall feels better, slept well. Then I asked him, don't go for ultrasound. And this ultrasound revealed normal. No evidence of any obvious bowel mass, any constriction. Abdomen on sonographic examination. And this was reported by me. So this patient responded very well with intussusception in acute disease. Then I will share one case of appendicitis. This is a 5-year-old, came for treatment. This is also after diagnostic. This is just 1 year now. Acute appendicitis on 10-7-2019. He was treated by local doctors for stomach pain. And then he was admitted in ICU because a lot of vomiting was there. When the pain, especially the vomiting, was a little better, he was referred for surgery, to which patient did not agree, came for him. This patient, I will tell you, the patient, whole family is under my care. And as soon as in ICU, they said, you have to undergo surgery because you have got appendicitis. They took and they told doctor, you please discharge us. We don't want treatment here. We don't want to. They requested doctor. The doctor said, you can go against advice, but it's not good because the child may have serious complication. But the party said, no, you leave it on us. And party came with all the reports from ICU directly to the clinic. This report, you can see tubular hypoechic lesion in the right iliac fossa, suggestive of acute appendicitis. Then some information was taken. patient hot, sweating mainly forehead. Patient was sweating even with the pain. Moderately build towards skin. Thirsty, takes water often and good cold. Dryness of mouth along with the pain. Craving for sweet. Peda he used to like. You know, Dharwad Peda he was specially mentioned. Cannot tolerate small corrections. Feel I am right. Say 5 years child. Doesn't want any correction. And he's got irregular food habits, irregular bowels, often passes falls with that. Pain better by hot application. Typical right lumbar pain. Not better by vomiting. You must have come to conclusion of certain medicine. And I'm sure you will lead to the right medicine. So this is also was given lycopodium 0/1 dose daily in morning empty stomach, and he was given colocynth earlier for the pain. I mean, not colocynth, sorry, colocynth was the earlier case. This case did not come for the pain. So he was given daily one dose, and he was given belladonna, but he has never used that. Patient reported after 3 weeks with ultrasound. Pain and all other complaints stopped for after 1 week of treatment, but he was asked to continue 0/1 daily morning. And this is the report of the child by me. No sonological abnormality detected, and everything was fine. No obvious mass, ascites, nothing in there. The patient said, so this is another acute case. But I will tell you one thing. These are all cases where you take risk. And don't take risk when you are not sure about the totality. See, here I could prescribe because I was very sure about the totality. And even Kent has said, even our experiences, when you are very sure about totality and indication, go ahead, patient will be responding. But if your totality is not clear, I will tell you, even a case of cough and cold will not respond to you. Our medicines act when there is totality, when there is indication. Aphorism 3, indication of disease has to be covered by the indication of medicine. No pain, appetite good, no vomiting, no nausea, advice to discontinue. Then another acute problem comes in most of our daily practice. Sorry. That is fever. What you have to look for in fever is fever totality. See, mostly fever has 3 stages, chill, heat, sweat. But sometimes we have only heat stage. Patient when comes, he has only heat stage. Don't worry. If chill stage is not there, take totality of heat stage or sweat stage. And what you have to inquire about each thing, about chill, you have to inquire, what is the time of chill? What is the type of chill? I mean, partial, where it starts. What are the aggravating things? What are the ameliorating things? And during chill, what else is present? Same thing, during heat, what is the time of heat? Morning, evening. Type of partial, only head, mostly head, feet, all those. What are the aggravating factors, ameliorating factors, and at the time of it, at the time of fever, what comes as a concomitant? If these things are there, I'm sure you'll be able to treat fever cases. How to treat a fever case? Look for stages and look for all these symptoms. One information I want to share with you. See, 3 days back, one patient is admitted in a private hospital, and the party, it's a big party, they approached me. It's a case of corona positive case, and left lung is almost collapsed. Patient is already diabetic, and kidney problems. When patient was admitted, patient had 81 oxygen level, and then it dropped to 51. And then the treating doctor said, there is no hope, the patient may die. Then the party came to me. It's a big party. I don't want to mention the name because it's still under treatment. So and then I gave arsenic because, you know, there was extreme weakness, extreme thirst, dryness. Then they said oxygen capacity of lung is deteriorating and hemoglobin also is less, oxygen carrying capacity is less. So I have given even vanadium. And now patient is taking arsenic album as well as vanadium alternating. You have to excuse me because these two medicines alternating I have given. This sometimes I alternate medicines because the Rustrix and Brania alternating was also recommended by Hani. And today, today the oxygen level has become 81 and the treating doctor is very happy and he says there may be good result. So they are hopeful. I'm just sharing because acute diseases, don't be afraid. Even the present problems of corona, if there are clear indication, we can treat. Only thing is we don't have all those kind of preventing us, protecting us measures. If you have all those, you can go ahead. So these are all acute things. Now I have come to the problem. Chronic cases, what is important is all steps you have to follow in detail. You have to follow case taking properly as instruction given to a homeopathic physician. You have to go for recording. Recording does not mean, you know, describing the symptoms. Describing properly with location, sensation, modalities, and even with intensity. See, what we miss mostly is the intensity of symptoms. Sometimes we just write, oh, craving for sweet, craving for salt. But 2 marks, 3 marks, relief by heat, 2 marks, 3 marks, will make your medicine very clear. Okay, then comes, after you have finished case taking recording, classification and evaluation. This I was telling about, dividing into common and uncommon. And evaluation means giving value, which is more important, which is less important. That means hierarchy. Once this is over, you can define the problem. Who is the patient and what is his suffering? That is called defining the problem. And then when you know who is patient, what is his disease, then you can go for a totality. Then you know what are the important symptoms of patient and disease. Then select whether it's a non-repertorial or repertorial. Then go for. And this is the ultimate thing, prescription. But see the latter, you have to go from one step to another. Then only you can have a successful prescription. Now this case I have shared earlier also in some of the conferences. Those who have witnessed this can go through once again. Because this is a very clear-cut case where within a month I got so much success. This all depends on the totality, I have told you. Totality clear, the patient will improve. That is also called predictive homeopathy in very, very literally says. In the very, very actual meaning says, every homeopathy is a predictive homeopathy. You can predict the result. So 30 years old girl had this back pain, and all this low, middle, up, neck, better by lying down, sitting, shoulder pain, neck pain, hands pain, finger pain. So all over the body there are pains, which is aggravation in the morning. Then see leg pain, knee pain, toes, frequent cold and cough in the morning. Nose block till sunrise, better by sun. Her all symptoms and complaints are caused and increased due to stress and anxiety, as it was very obvious before exams and before going to school. Patient stays in a cold place where there are heavy rains, and major part of the year there is always raining. So he used to get exposed to cold, rains, and used to suffer from cold very often. She also found the study was a difficult task to her. Often she used to be nervous in the school when she was asked to stand and answer. Slowly, she started getting back pain while sitting long in the school. Next to that, she started hand while completing the homework. The parents, one is teacher and another is a business wife, they used to pressurize her to get good marks and perform better than her neighbor friend. See, this is one very, very sad point. When the patient came for interview, case taking, I asked, how much marks you get? She said 94%. But she was crying while telling 94%. I said 94% and you are telling as if you are failed with so sad mouth and all these things. And with the tears, she said, no, but you know, my friend, she has got 96%. So her whole sadness was comparing because the parents had a good name in the society. They always used to boost, oh, my child is very intelligent, doing much, much better. And then when neighbor friend got little more, you know, they were depressed and they were pressurizing too much to her. You have to study better. You have to get more marks than her. Their aim was not to get more percentage. Even if 60% is there, it's good. But the neighbor must get 59%. It was like that. See the comparative world spoiling the children. Progressively, her pain became worse and she started getting even neck pain, knee pain. She used to be very anxious in the morning, even in the bed while getting up, thinking of going to school. Since her mother was seropositive rheumatoid patient, that alarmed her and the patient was taken to rheumatologist. After thorough examination, lab investigation, she was diagnosed rheumatoid arthritis. Now see, rheumatoid arthritis in a small child. Now she has a big life and she will be under a steroid for the whole life because there are no under treatment in other system of medicine. So she was treated with the steroids, painkiller, but the pain came back again. This is a report. You can see RF factor is 24, CRP 19. These are all suggestive of rheumatoid arthritis. ESR 25. It's a close look at the same report. Then, you know, next she was taken to Ayurvedic. And Ayurvedic, she did not get much relief, but she reduced her weight because of, you know, so much restriction about diet. And she was feeling like nauseating all the time because of the medicine, because of the diet restriction, she lost weight also. So finally, parents, you know, changed the place from Medicare to Mangalore. But her suffering continued. Finally, they came for home. So we have taken some more details. Thin built, menses regular, painful on the first day, bleeding scanty, joint pains also increases around menses. Chilly but extreme of heat is also introduced, sweating pocket. White dots in the nail, appetite good, likes pastries, cake, chicken. Chicken causes gas and acidity. Constipated, hard stool. And constipation was worse 2 days before the periods. Very sensitive, no anger at all, shy, anxious, nervous. All the problems increases and caused by anxiety. Can't face stairs and crowd. Anxiety increases her sweating. Feels like hitting herself. Feels like crying, sensitive to touch. Father, this is a family history, 50 years old, having diabetes. Mother, 45 years, RA patient. Brother, 16 years, cold and cough. And paternal grandfather was diabetic. maternal grandfather, not much now. Paternal grandmother and maternal grandmother had old age arthritis. Now, what is the problem definition? So, problem definition means in one paragraph, you have to say what you have understood about the patient and about the disease. Patient who is sensitive, anxious, timid, easily affected by anxieties, having criticism, who is also stressed because of the parents, who is chilly, likes to be in the sun, suffering from child pains, diagnosis, I think now totality will be clear. So, as I have told you, divide the whole case into common and uncommon. What are the common symptoms in this? Back pain, knee pain, leg pain, neck pain, all these pains. Frequent cold and cough, nose block, RF factor positive, ESR high, and rheumatoid arthritis. These are all common symptoms. What are the uncommon? The modality, the type of pain, and again general modality, then general mental state and cause. Anxiety causes and increases all the complaints. Painful menses first day, sweating palm and soles, craving pastries and cake, constipation during and after menses, mental and physical exertion aggravates. Now once totality is clear, we have to see how to go about it. You can, if you feel you know the medicine, you can go directly prescribe medicine. If you're not very sure, you can go for reportage. So these are the main evaluation of symptoms. First is causative modality, anxiety, emotions. Then physical modalities, mental and physical exertion. Concomitant menses before and during constipation. Location and sensation, joints inflamed. In nutshell, these are the whole synthesis of the case. What is available in this case? Let us have a thinking over this case. We have got cause, we have got complaints, we have got modalities, we have got mental state, we have got concomitants. Which repertory and method would you like to see? See, if you go by the hierarchy, you can go by Bober's. But this case can also be repertorized by Thind's method. This is a very good case for both methods. But we have followed the instruction given by Boger, cause, complaints, modalities, and concomitant. So Boger repertory was referred, and these are emotion aggravates causative modalities, emotion fright, anxiety, causative modalities, exertion mental aggravates modalities, exertion physical aggravates modalities, and menstruation constipation before, menstruation constipation during, cold tendencies, sensation complaints in general, that chapter does not. Joints inflamed also is given in sensation complaints in general. So these are the rubrics taken, and then we have gone for repertorization. And you see Nux Vomica, Silesia, Pulsatilla, these three medicines are coming on the top. I'm sure you know the prescription. Medicine which came prominently are these three. Then patient is chilly, ameliorated by sun, white dots on the nail. And then she was given silesia. Since the patient was staying far, she was prescribed medicine for a month. Seeing the pathology sensitivity of the patient, she was given Silesia 30, one dose, once a week, along with placebo. And she was asked to report after a month with the report, with the investigation, blood. And see, patient exactly comes after a month. Pains, all joint pains are better. She can write and do all the work. She is able to ride bicycle, which she was not able to do so. Constipation better. Menstrual pain, constipation during, much better. Feeling general tiredness after school is present. She was prescribed Cilicia 200 single dose with placebo. See, it's not only the pain has improved, the whole patient has improved. And see, this is the report. You can see the report. See it closely. RF factor has become normal. ESR has become much less. And then you can understand patient is cured. So after Cilicia 200 was given, patient was told to discontinue. Then one more case, that is last case of that clinical totality. What is clinical totality? How to go about this? See, about clinical totality, some of our stalwarts are against, because they say it's not exactly the similarity of the patient, but it's a similarity of the pathology, which some of the physicians did not favor. Even Hahnemann did not favor. But in Hahnemann's time only, like Burnett and all those, they were following this method and they were getting good success. Now see what James Clark did. Certain diseases come to have certain and all the patients who are found to be suffering from any given disease must be dosed with one of the remedies related to it. Crompton was very clear, you see. But the fact is, we need any and every way of finding the right remedy. Simple, simile, simple symptomatic syndrome, and furthest the pathological syndrome. And I maintain, see how much stress he has given. I maintain that we are still within the line of homeopathy, that is an expansive, progressive science. This was a case of liver abscess. See, clinical method I suggest you follow only when there are not many characteristics here in the case. But along with this, along with your pathological symptoms, there may be some modalities and compounds that you can take for differentiation of medicines. So from pathological symptoms, you'll get a group. That group of medicines you can differentiate with the help of concomitant and modalities. So this liver case also was a very, very serious case, but somehow, you know, homeopathy has helped it. This is a He also has come with the liver abscess report. I'll show you the report afterwards. He had a complaint of pain in the right upper abdomen with restless and increased temperature. He also suffered from severe weakness and body ache along with bitter taste in the mouth. He went to a hospital for checkup and treatment. The ultrasonography revealed liver abscess of 7 into 5.9 centimeters. And you can see this report, liver abscess with early areas of tissue breakdown. He was advised immediate hospitalization and treatment, including surgery, but he did not wish to go for operation. Hence, he came for homeopathic treatment. And this is the paper he brought. Please admit liver abscess. Then in case appetite, don't feel like eating, slight nausea, easily satiated. This is a common symptom in liver abscess. No desire for food, but can relish a slight pungent food, likes hot food. Bitter taste in mouth. No change in thirst, but prefers to take water frequently. Constipated, sweat, forehead. A little anxious about the prognosis. Don't want to go for any surgery. So this is also common symptoms when you have such disease and advise surgery. Little anxiety is common. Likes cold weather up South India, world's fine. So I have gone for clinical method where there are few symptoms only. So we have taken liver hypochondria as a location. Abscess hypochondria is a diagnostic symptom. Bitter taste, though it is a common concomitant, but if it is very prominent, you can take. And no other thing you have, so you have to have this. sweat, forehead is also concomitant. Constipated, concomitant. Concomitant means other symptoms, which may be in clinical cases is mostly associated symptoms. And then again, we have come for these few medicines, laxatives, sedation. On 20th month, he was prescribed sedation once a week, empty stomach, advised to report for follow-up after 10 days, because he, I was very careful in this follow-up. Though he was staying, you know, he's actually from Bhatkal. I'm mentioning because he has told me, he can share my case. So he said, I can come after a long time. I said, no, he had to come 10 days, and you have to do ultrasound every week. He said, no, after 10 days, I'll come and ultrasound. And he was advised a strict diet and rest. In the 10 days after report, irregular hypoechoic lesion in the right lobe of the liver, suggestive of liver abscess. So it is around here. Appetite good, liver abscess compared to just 1 millimeter. But patient was feeling better, and at least he was not worst. And symptoms are little improving. You see, better, bitter taste is better, and weakness is better. So one, because not showing very expected result, one tuberculinum one mass intercurrent was given, and silicia 30 once a week was continued. Then after 15 days, it comes again. With ultrasound, resolving abscess in the right lower liver. And this is a good sign, you know, that has given a lot of relief to patient as well as me. So you see a liver abscess size has come down. And it, they have written resolving abscess. Then patient was given size of 200 and was asked to come after a report with liver function test, because I wanted to verify that. And see, this is ultrasound here. Liver is normal in size and no focal mass lesion detected in both the lobes. So patients is fully relieved from the liver. Liver function test also normal. So what a relief and satisfaction it gives, you know, when patient responds so well. So this ultrasound says normal, abscess resolved, advised to stop medicine. Patient overall better, but has little flatulence. He was asked to discontinue the treatment. So what conclusion we derive? Homeopathic system is a complete system of therapy and effective treatment of all kinds of diseases. Like any other system of medicine, homeopathy do have its limitation and scope. Success of treatment is proportional to adhering to the principles and practice. Methodology of treatment depends on the type of case and also what is available in the case. I will suggest you don't stick to one method. Don't say, I'm Kantian, I'm Bulgarian, I'm Bunning-Hessianian, or I'm some kind of, now nowadays all stalwarts are also having a brand. Don't identify yourself as a brand. Identify yourself as a homeopath and go for practice which is based on principles. Then you will get good result. And the last is, homeopathy treats all type of cases. The result can be cure, palliation, or a short relief. I'll tell you, even in case of cancer, pain, and all this, our medicines are very effective. But the result depends on the totality. Short relief, for that also homeopathy is indicated. So don't say that we are not useful treating a very, very severe cases. In severe cases where relief only is expected, you can do the relief. Where cure is expected, you can do the cure. Practice well, homeopathy can give you everything. Stick to principle when you are practicing. Don't deviate. Thank you very much. So I've come to the end, Dr. Kamal.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. I think, as I said, today we will walk with sir along the path of prescribing in homeopathy. And sir has made a very beautiful presentation stressing on the principles and concepts of homeopathy and stressing on the importance of the similarity or the similimum, identifying the common symptoms, uncommon symptoms, differentiating them, and also the utilization of repertory in the chronic cases. And the presentation was an effective one. And I had to, or it took me back to the classes of sir and you're studying BHMS. Sir, thanks a lot. Any questions from the audience? I think all are telling thank you, thank you, thank you so much, sir.
Very good. They can contact me even through their emails, phone numbers.
Yeah.
I'm always happy to answer.
I think that is an open invitation to for all the participants to ask any doubts other than the presentation what sir has given. Maybe the difficult cases also they can share with sir and ask opinion. Isn't it, sir?
Yes.
Yeah.
See, I'm a very open person. I don't hide my prescription. Even yes. Patients want to know the medicine, I can give them right prescription also.
Sir, that's what, as I said, sir is a very simple person and a classical homeopath through and through. And he is a teacher always. That's what the class or that's what the presentation has been. Like a class for us, that it has taken us back to the days when we studied the BHMS. Yeah. I don't think, sir, there are any questions.
All right, good.
Okay, sir, there is one person is asking, what about the doses of arsenic to the COVID patients? What is your take on that?
See, the patient which I am treating is a very serious patient, and left lung, half of that lung is collapsed. I have got, its picture in the mobile which was given to me, but since the case is not fully cured, I don't want to share that. So I was given arsenic 31st, but now today they have taken arsenic and vanadium 6 every 2 hours alternative. That has made their oxygen level to 81 from 51. And that doctor and party is very happy. Now we don't know what will happen tomorrow. But if this case is successful, certainly I will share later sometime.
Okay, sir. There is another question.
Yeah.
Sir, there, another question. What is the potency for vanadium?
Six. That is
sir,
what recommended. When I prescribe small medicines, I follow Boric's instruction.
Yeah. Sir, whether there will be whenever there will be aggravation if we change from LM potency to decimal scale.
See, first thing is LM potency. There are no aggravation. But if at all you have aggravation, I think you can go for higher potency in LM only. If 0.1 is giving aggravation, go for 0.3 or 0 many more. That will be a finer potency and it may cause some good result. Mm. But shifting to LM to centesimal, mostly I have not done. From centesimal to LM potency, I have done.
Okay. Sir, there is this one. Why tuberculina was given?
Tuberculina, and after 15 days, there is a not expected result. So, what is the indication of intercurrent is when medicine is totally indicated, even if you revise the case, you find same totality. And if that is not giving you expected result, you can introduce tuberculina or whatever is intercurrent. Here, tuberculin again, because there is abscess, there is a pus formation, and there is a temperature. So pathological intercurrent, as well as the patient was tuberculin from some symptoms. So Tivakulinam was apt at this place.
Sir, one more question. Can fractures of L4, L5 can cure with homeopathic medicines?
Fractures, first thing is we have to do mechanical management. We have to make the bones, both the parts together. And then, see, fractures are not cured by medicine in allopathy. But we have medicines, you know, like Simfitam. And I'll suggest to you, there is a bone chapter in Bogar Boningasan's repertory. And fracture, non-healing fracture, late healing fracture, recurring fractures, there are many good rubrics. So we can treat fracture cases, wherever it is, not L4, L3. But there has to be a mechanical management first. Both ends of the bone has to be put together so that healing process can take place.
Sir, Dr. Rama Lahiri is asking, can we use homeopathy medicines for autistic patient of age 24?
You can use that, but the possibility of cure is not there. At age of 23, we don't expect cure, but certainly there will be some improvement in behavior. Because I have treated people with autistic, but in beginning when they come, they improve. If they have come very late, after 15 years, there are no cure.
Sir, one more from Galaxy is asking, it seems he or she has faced lots of challenges treating endometriosis cases. Could you please share your experiences on the same?
Endometriosis, bleeding and pain should be treated at the time when it is required. Acute totality of the take. And then take constitutional totality to give on 5th or 6th day of the period. Constitution can be anything like CPR, Natrum, Platina, all those female medicines or any medicines will come as a constitutional. Pain medicines and bleeding medicines you have to select like Sabina, Thalaspi, even Aramur Natrum. These are all hydrostasis muriaticum. It's a good medicine for bleeding. So give acute medicines at the time of suffering, followed by constitutional medicine, mostly on the 5th day of the periods. So in few months, you will find there is a good relief.
Sir, there is one person, Dr. HK, is asking how to manage patients with operated gallbladder and then have the problems of acidity.
See here, you have to take symptoms of the patient, and if you want to have without palliative treatments, then you know, like Stabisagria. And some acidity medicines you have to give what is that tincture is there? Robenia and all those things. But plan for constipation.
Okay.
And sir, his way of life has been cut.
Sir, Suresh Barak is asking, appendicitis case, Lyco-0-1 repeated many days. Is it so? We will continue 0-1 till the improvement is on?
Yes. It was continued till the patient became all right. See, 0-1 we can repeat even in acute cases, though it is a chronic remedy, but it's indicated. So it was given in 0-1 potency. And when the pain was little better, you know, they were planning for operation. That was the stage when patient came. So Lyco-0-1 was given frequent repetition.
Okay. Sir, what is the scope of homeopathy in keloids?
Not very good. But if it is a small keloid, yes, we have silicea, floricacin, calcarea flor. They are all good medicines, but see that they are indicated, you know, just don't give it.
Sir, one person is asking, is there any chance for a cure in patient of 50 years with rheumatoid arthritis?
Depends what are the complications settled in the bones. If there are deformities, then certainly only you can give palliative treatment and relief. There may not be cure. Depends on the stage of disease. Suppose the patient comes with all deformity and his age also is so much, and if he has other complicated diseases also, the chances are very less. But palliative treatments at all stages can be given by homeopathic medicines.
Sir, Sir, what is your take on genetic disorders?
Genetic disorders, chromosomal disorders, and inborn disorders are difficult to cure in humans. Symptomatic relief can be given, but no cure. I can say frankly, no cure.
Okay. So there are many more questions. Can 60-year-old male stage 4 Hodgkin's lymphoma case can be treated?
See, these type of questions in homeopathy are very difficult to answer. Mm-hmm. And you see the indication of the patient, pathology, indication, the disease, the stage of disease. You can't predict cure or palliation. But treat it. I will suggest you treat all kind of cases when you find there are indications. Indications are there means at least palliation will be done. Patient will be better. But you know what you are doing. You should know.
Sir, Ajay is asking, type 2 cases, type 2 diabetes mellitus cases, early age is better with homeopathy. What is your experience?
Type 2 cases of diabetes, if they come initially, mostly if they have not taken any medicine, then around 90% cases are cured by homeopathy. And the treatment is constitutional. Just constitutional, with mode of life should be corrected, with the cause if there are some stress, and suggest healthy way of life, you know, like walking, eating habit, sleeping habit. Then most of these diabetic patients are cured if they come in the beginning. I can say within 1 year if they come, slowly you can taper down their medicine also. And if they come without taking any medicine, 95% they are cured.
Sir, Nikhil Govind is asking, Silesian last case of liver abscess having thermal scald and wants fan. So we have to consider thermals or not?
Thermal, you should not consider when other symptoms are very prominent. Because thermals sometimes don't guide us properly. Sometimes this is a wrong interpretation also. A patient is habituated of fan, we like fan. It's not because of disease and absence of disease. But if other symptoms are prominent, then go for medicine.
Okay. Sir, Dr. Vinita is asking, good time to give constitutional medicine in chronic cases for males and females?
Pardon, what is the time?
Time, when to give for males and females constitutional medicine? Introduce.
Depends on the male. See, if it is a self, we give most in the morning empty stomach. If it is a lachesis, give most morning. Because they have aggravation.
Sir, no, sir. Sir, no, sir. I think the question was keeping in mind. Some people say that when the woman is having her menstrual cycles, not to give constitution. After cycles, only give the constitutional medicine like that.
Correct. That is true. Constitutional medicine in a female, we give mostly on the first day. And that's very effective. In any case, in any chronic case, including infertility and all those, you know, fifth day of period is the best time for a female. Male can be any day.
Okay. Sir, Dr. Jasna is asking, up to how much mm we can treat in the gallbladder stones?
That is very difficult because see,
I think she's a list of questions coming up.
Not go for obstruction. So I think is always advisable.
If it is not causing obstruction, you can treat.
Yes.
Simple. Okay. What is homeopathic medicines for osteoporosis, varicose seal, all that?
These are all, ask them to look in therapy or in therapy.
Okay. I think our time is coming closer and closer. I think all of you can take down Sir's email ID.
Yes.
And ask him the question straight and have a private conversation with Sir on the mail. Sir, I will give your mail ID to all.
Yes. Yeah, I can give mail ID and phone number also.
Phone number also. Okay. It is SHAPAMASA at Gmail, no sir?
No, at yahoo.com.
At yahoo.com.
That is spelling what you said was
yahoo.coin. Okay, yahoo.coin.
yahoo.coin.
Okay. Shapamasa at yahoo.co.in. In.
Yes.
And says phone number also I give. Says phone number 94483 88097. I think all of you please take down the mail ID and sir's phone number, and you can contact sir for all your difficulties or any questions that you have in your practice, and sir will be answering your questions. Okay, and sir, thanks a lot from us.
Yeah, it was very nice. It was very nice.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Dr. Shiv.
Yeah. As we have come to an end of this awesome session, I like to thank today's speaker, Dr. S.K. Tiwari, for giving his valuable time for us and sharing his knowledge. I also like to thank our administrator, Reverend Father Roshan Krasa, for giving us such an opportunity, and Principal Dr. Shivaprasad K, Vice Principal Dr. E.S.K. Prabhukiran, for being backbone always. I also like today's thank today's moderator, Dr. Madhav Kamath, for being there always and supporting us. Also, I like to thank all the delegates who are present today. Okay. And also, we have an awesome session today. We had an awesome session today with around 650 participants. Okay. I think it is a great thing for us. Okay. Also, I like to inform our delegates about tomorrow's session. It will be by Dr. Akhil S.S. and the topic is Gynecological and Thyroid Disorder, Scope in Homeopathy. Thank you. Have a good night. Stay safe.
Thank you. Thank you.
So we'll stop now.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You can stop now.